It said, let's round everybody up after a long summer with vacations, school's back in session. Let's start and kick off the fall with a great Western roundup and a Western-themed Sunday morning.
It's fun to have a nice theme day like this and do some things that we can laugh together and eat together and be together. But God, it's only possible because of you. And so we want to experience your presence. As we look into your word, as we continue to sing, as we have dinner, God, we just want to experience your presence because we know that the only thing that really satisfies is being one with you and then loving one another.
But, you know, I've always had this dream. Maybe one day they would let me sing up here on the worship team. But I don't know. So I wrote this song. I thought it might inspire the worship team, maybe give me an audition or something. But here it is. When I asked Jesus in my heart, he gave me salvation and a brand new start. So I prayed for help, choose my ministry. Well, I've always had this dream that I would sing with the worship team. We would lift our voices to the Lord in harmony. We'd sing a praise, sing thanksgiving for peace in our hearts as love is bringing. We would praise the Lord and everyone would stand. One of these days, and it won't be long, I'll join the worship team in a song. We'd sing about the love of Jesus throughout the land. When I would get out my guitar, my wife and kids would scatter far. Even my cat would hide, which was rather odd. But I'm so thankful for my new song friends. They are faithful to the end. 'Cause Herb taught us all that suffering brings us closer to God. We'd sing a praise, sing with thanksgiving for peace in our hearts as love is bringing. We would praise the Lord and everyone would stand. One of these days, and it won't be long, I'll join the worship team in a song. We would sing about the love of Jesus throughout the land. I will persevere in the end, with the help of my new song friends. If they're serving food, I know that they all will stay. I believe it'll be winter time when that spotlight will be mine. 'Cause I overheard the pastor say it would be a cold day. We'd sing a praise, sing with thanksgiving for peace in our hearts as love is bringing. We would praise the Lord and everyone would stand. One of these days, and it won't be long, I'll join the worship team in a song. But until then, I'll just be happy in this hoedown band. But until then, I'll just be happy in this hoedown band.
Well, let's see what's in my bag today. Anybody know what this is? It's a box. Anybody know what this is? A necklace. But it's a special kind of necklace. Can you see it? Yeah, it's got kids on it. It's called a mother's necklace. If you look real close, how many do you see? There's four. That's right. And it's because this belongs to Mrs. Sheriff, my wife. And we have four kids. And so this has the birthstones of each one of our kids. So that's Andrew, Carissa. You recognize them? Amber and Chad. Now, why would Sheila wear a necklace like that with pictures or with little people there of her kids? Why would she do that? Because what? To show that she's a mom, yeah.
Or if she goes away sometimes, she could look at that.
Yeah, because she could look at it, remember the kids, yeah. And because she loves them. Isn't that amazing? She loves them, and so she's proud of them. And so she wears a mother's necklace to show everybody that she's proud. But not only that, another box. Oops. Yep.
I knew it.
How did you, what did you know? That was a ring. You see how many different stones there are there?
Four.
You see? Four different stones, and they all are the birthstones of the four kids. Andrew, Carissa, Amber, and Chad. Do you recognize them? No, they don't look like that at all, do they? Why would she wear a ring like that? Because she loves them, and she's proud of them, and she's glad she's their mom. But not only that, another box. Anybody know what this is? A locket. Really? Think there's pictures in there? Well, let's see if I can figure it out. How about that? Can you see it?
I never saw one of those.
Never saw one of those. I know. I didn't either. It comes open. They had to make them because we just kept having kids and had to have enough places for all the pictures. Good thing we didn't have another one or we'd been real in trouble, wouldn't we? But there they are, baby pictures of each one. Andrew, Carissa, Amber, and Chad. They all look the same when they're little. So why would she wear that?
Because
she loves them. She's proud of them. And she loves remembering when they were babies. But not only that, this is, I stole her wallet when she wasn't looking. Actually, I didn't. Oh, you said there wasn't any money in here. Ooh, I'm going to town afterwards. Can you see? What's on the outside of her wallet?
Pictures.
Who's that guy?
You.
I guess she had to put me somewhere, huh? But there they are. There's four of them. So every time she gets out her money to go shopping, which is like 17 times a day, she sees her kids. Why would she put a picture on something that she looks at all the time? To remember them, because she loves them, because she's proud of them. Where does God keep your picture?
Everywhere.
Everywhere. I think if God had a wallet, he would have your picture there. I think so. Why? Because he loves us. He'd need millions and millions of wallets, wouldn't he? But I think every person that has ever been born, God would put in his wallet or put in his locket or remember, because he loves us even more than our moms or our dads or our grandmas or our grandpas or our aunts or our uncles or anybody. And he, and just like Miss Sheila has all of these things to remember, but they're not really in a locket or a ring, are they? They're in her heart. And that's where God has us. We're in his heart. And every time he looks at you, he smiles because he loves you, and you are in his heart. So, because God has us in his heart, where should we put God? In our hearts, too. To love him more than anything else. So, we're really glad that you're here. If you're first-time guests, we don't dress like this all the time. Nor do we let Russ sing all the time. But we always enjoy being together, because it's about being with God and being together. So let's talk about Jesus' idea of the church today. Jesus' idea of the church. Say this with me. It's not about religion. It's about relationships. And that's really the kind of the slogan that I've been focused on hearing saying a lot in recent days. It's not about religion, it's about relationships. And that is what Jesus' idea of church is all about. If Jesus were here today, what would he think about all this Western Roundup stuff? Would it matter to him how we dressed? Would it matter to him what kind of music we sang, as long as it was honoring to him? Would it matter whether we were having food after worship? Would it matter whether we had horses out here, or cows, or sheep, or anything else? Wouldn't matter any of those things. Because what the Bible says is that Jesus is all about people. Truth is, there are some people who would look at this and go, this isn't church. This doesn't look right. It doesn't smell right. It doesn't feel right. But the truth is, if you go a few thousand miles south, it doesn't look like what we normally do. A few thousand miles in any direction, you could walk into a place where they were having church, and it would be different music. It would look different. People would be dressed different. People would act different. There's just all kinds of different things about it. But would it matter to Jesus? The only thing that would matter to Jesus are people looking to him. Are people loving him? Are people loving one another? Because it's not about religion. It's about relationship. What was it Jesus had in mind when he talked about the church? Well, what I do know, I can say with confidence, as you look into the Bible, he wasn't thinking about a building. In fact, he wasn't even thinking about a place, whether it was a hillside or a cave or wherever. And he wasn't thinking about a certain way of organizing. And he wasn't thinking about rituals or liturgies. And he wasn't trying to establish any kind of religion. Jesus was doing something very different. He talked about establishing a kingdom. And those who were listening to him had some mistaken ideas, because when they heard kingdom, they thought of earthly kingdoms. But that's not what Jesus was about. He wasn't there to do what people thought he was going to do, because he was establishing a kingdom that is different than what this world sees. In Luke chapter 17, if you want to pull your sermon notes out, in Luke chapter 17, Jesus talked about this. He said, once, having been asked by the Pharisees when the kingdom of God would come, because Jesus talked about the kingdom of God a lot, and they were thinking an earthly kingdom. They were thinking he would banish the Romans, and he would establish an earthly kingdom, and he would sit on an earthly throne and have an earthly palace, and he would release and rescue all of the oppressed physically. And so they were asking him, when is the kingdom going to come? Jesus replied, the kingdom of God does not come with your careful observation, nor will people say, here it is or there it is, because the kingdom of God, say those last few words with me, is within you. And I got to believe that the Pharisees, the religious rulers of the day, were standing there scratching his heads going, what is he talking about now? They never heard of this kind of a kingdom before. It's not an earthly kingdom, he says, but rather it's within us. It's where Christ rules within us. And as a result, we love God and we love other people because we realize that it's about relationship. And so what is God's church? What is Jesus' idea of church is an absolutely essential question, because on that rest determines whether we really are in relationship with him and headed for an eternity with him. Matthew chapter 16, we started looking at last week, and we'll dig in a little bit deeper over the weeks ahead. It says, when Jesus came to the region of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, who do people say the Son of Man is? They replied, some say John the Baptist, others say Elijah, and still others, Jeremiah, or one of the prophets. But what about you, he asked, who do you say that I am? And that was the core question, and it was the first time Jesus ever demanded that the disciples deal with that question. Simon Peter answered, you are the Christ, or the Messiah, the Son of the living God. Jesus replied, blessed are you, Simon, son of Jonah, for this was not revealed to you by man, but by my Father in heaven. And I tell you that you are Peter, and on this rock referring to the statement that Peter made on this truth, on this rock, that I am the Christ, the Son of the living God. On that truth, on me, I will build my church. Now notice, it's Jesus' church, and he's the one that's going to build it. And the gates of Hades will not overcome it. I will give you the keys of the kingdom, and whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven. Whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven. Then he warned his disciples not to tell anyone that he was the Christ. What Jesus established under the name church, and the word that he uses there for the very first time, church, ecclesia, a called out gathering of his people, was not a religion. And at the core, it is different from anything else, any other organization, any other group of people, because it's all about relationships. We see it as Jesus spent his time on earth. We see it in the following generations as the apostles recorded in the book of Acts, as Paul came in to the church. We see it all, that every true ecclesia, every true gathering, every true church of Jesus Christ is all about relationships. So let's talk about what Jesus' people need to do. If we're to be his church, if we're to really experience life as it's been designed to be experienced, the satisfying life that Jesus created us for, what do we need to do? Number one, we need to surrender to the loving, powerful God. If we're to be his church, and if we're to experience life as God designed it to be lived, if we're to experience the relationship with him and relationship with one another, then first and foremost, it's about Jesus. Excuse me. It's about surrendering to him, but not just surrendering to a God, surrendering to the loving, powerful God. Because there were a lot of other religions and still existing today that demand a surrender to a being, but it's not the loving, powerful God. Jesus wanted us to understand that the true God is nothing like what the devil or in our humanity we think he would be. And so when Jesus chose the place where he would reveal his true identity, he chose a place where there were many, many spiritual places. Caesarea Philippi was about 120 miles north of Jerusalem. He didn't do it in Jerusalem, the political capital, but rather he did it far away from there in a place where there were all kinds of religious influences. It was Gentile territory, non-Jewish territory. And they had Jewish synagogues there. They also had a Syrian temple, huge Syrian temple to the god Baal that you read a lot about in the Old Testament. In fact, there were 14 different temples to this god, little g, Baal. There was also a huge temple to the Greek god, Pan. And then there was a huge temple to Caesar himself, because the Romans believed that he was God. And so in the midst of all of that, surrounded by all of that, Jesus asked his disciples for the first time. And I think look around you. Who do people say that I am? Because everything hinges on that question. Over there, you see the temple of Baal. Well, actually, all 14 of them are spread around. You see over there? Over there, you see the Greek god Pan. Over there, you see the Roman god Caesar Augustus, and even the Jewish synagogues over there. You see all of those things. Now, who do people say that I am? Because there's all these gods, little g gods, all around you. Who do people say that I am? It was as if Jesus was pointing to the temple Baal and says, not a god. To Pan, not a god. Caesar Augustus, not a god. Even to the synagogue saying, not the god that you think he is. So who do people say that I am? Everything rests on this question. Because if we're going to experience life as it's created to be lived, with the satisfaction life, we have to be one with the one true God. We have to be in relationship with the one true God. And throughout Jesus' teachings, we find him telling us about God in the context of relationships. So Peter says, you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. And what we see in Jesus is what God is really all about. So what do we do? It's surrender to the loving, powerful God. Every other religion, every other God, little g, is a demanding system of trying to keep God off your back. Am I right? If you've been exposed to it, no matter where you go, it's about a God who is far away and a God who you're trying to do whatever you can to keep him happy and off your back. And Jesus says, no, I'm very different than that. And I'll show you. And he's been showing the disciples for 3 years now. So what is it we need to do? First off, the first bullet point there is we need to trust. We need to trust. It's, you know, you can obey and you can try to keep a God little g off your back and never trust him. In fact, there are a lot of religions where the gods are the opposite of trustworthy. But Jesus comes and he says, I am the God. And if you're going to experience life, then you have to trust me. You have to lean into me. You have to depend upon me. You have to believe what I have to say. And you have to put your full weight on me. You know, surrender or trust is easy. Well, easy. Easier, maybe. Trust and surrender is easy if you believe in the character and the competence of the person that you're trusting or surrendering to. When our family gets together, my oldest son Andrew is 31 years old now, and when our family gets together, I'm sitting around and we'll say, okay, what are we going to do tomorrow? And when that question comes up, everybody looks at Andrew. Because Andrew loves to plan trips, he loves to find sightseeing things, he loves to find interesting restaurants, he loves to find very interesting places to see. And so everybody has learned that if you want to really have a good time on vacation, the best thing you can do is just let Andrew handle it. And so everybody looks at Andrew. And so when we're out in Seattle this last time, we were sitting around one day and said, well, what are you going to do tomorrow? And everybody looked at Andrew and he just laughed. He said, I'm just waiting for somebody else to plan something. And my thought was, why should we? Because you've never let us down. You've always planned something, and we can trust that whatever you do is going to be good. And so it's easy to trust. In fact, I would be willing to go on a vacation and say, Andrew, just point me in the direction every day. I'll go wherever you want me to go. I'll do whatever you want me to do, because I know that you're going to always provide something that you know I'm going to enjoy and is going to be enjoyable with the rest of the family. I trust you. Can you do that with God? Can you get up every day and say, God, whatever you want today? Only if you trust him. And see, that's different than all the other gods that have ever existed, because they're not trustworthy. They don't have the system that they're a part of. They're not even real, but the system that has been developed around them, they don't have our best interests in mind. And so we have to trust, but then we also have to obey. That's the next bullet point. It's still, even though you trust, it's sometimes still hard to obey, because we can't see what Jesus sees and we can't understand what God is always up to. But to not to obey is not to trust. Look at what Jesus says in Luke chapter 6. Beginning with verse 46, he says, why do you call me Lord, Lord, God, Messiah, King of my life? Why do you call me Lord, Lord, and do not do what I say? I will show you what he is like who comes to me and hears my words and puts them into practice. He's like a man building a house who dug down deep and laid the foundation on the rock. When the flood came, the torrent struck that house but could not shake it because it was well built. He says, so if you trust me and you obey me and you do what I say, even if you don't understand, even when it looks like it, you could just build right on top of this ground. Nothing's going to happen here. It looks good. And God says, no, you got to dig deep. You got to do something different. Can you trust him to obey him even when you don't understand what he's up to or how he's going to work it out? He says, if you can do that, then when the difficulties come, you'll still be standing. But, verse 49, the one who hears my words and does not put them into practice is like a man who built a house on the ground without a foundation. The moment the torrent struck that house, it collapsed and its destruction was complete. He says, if we decide we're going, okay, I'll make you Lord, but except there are a couple of areas of my life here where, God, what you're telling me doesn't make any sense, so I'm not going to do that. I'll do everything else, but I'm not going to do that. There's going to come a storm someday that'll blow your life away. To trust in this loving, powerful God is to say, I'll do whatever he says, even if I don't understand it, even if it doesn't make sense. I've asked Rich Offerman to come up and share about a situation where he really had to trust and obey and what God did in the midst of it.
So back in June, Jamie was with her mom and her stepdad on vacation, and she got hit by a cigarette lighter that was thrown in anger at her mom. She got hit dead in the eye with it. And when we went to the doctors, there was four different doctors that looked into her eye and said that there was going to be some permanent damage. One of the things being her iris was wide open, her eye was completely dilated. They said that would never work again. The only thing that they could do is later on down the line, put some stitches in it to make it permanently closed more. And that was pretty hard to hear. But, we all here prayed for her. And when they did the surgery to correct the cataract that lighter caused, the doctor found that the iris was fused to the pupil. So he cut a little portion of it to get it freed. And after the surgery was all done, the next day they took the bandage off of her eye. And he was very excited. And he didn't show me what he was seeing that had him so excited. But a couple days later, we went back and they were checking how her vision was coming along. And he showed me her iris is working.
Amen. And we prayed, went to the doctor. It didn't seem like anything was happening. Didn't seem like anything was happening. That's a part of what trust and obeying is. It's, we don't understand. God could have, and it would have been healed. He didn't choose to do it. For whatever reason, he's got a bigger picture. He's got a bigger understanding. But then God did the miraculous. And Rich was texting me or emailing me, and he was saying, everybody's surprised. Everybody around that whole situation, the medical community is just shocked. Could it be that that's part of the thing that God wants to do? See, we don't know, but trust and obey. When it doesn't make sense, lean into God, trust and obey. If we're to experience what God wants to do in our lives, if we're to experience satisfaction and experience being the church, it is absolutely essential that we surrender to trust and obey to the loving, powerful God. Kathy? Right. Right. Yep. 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 Yeah. God has a bigger picture. It's a bigger picture, and we don't understand it, and we won't understand a lot of things until we get to heaven. That's why it's trust. I have to trust. The second, number two, is to connect. Connect. Connect in strong relationships with followers. Before I talk about that, though, let me just pause it and go back just a step. In your life, is there any place where you're not trusting or obeying? Is there anything that God has told you to do that you're hesitating? Maybe you're not saying, God, I'm not going to do that, but you're just putting it on the back burner. Is there any place where you're not leaning into him? Something that you're holding on to, saying, I'm going to rule this myself. Because if you are, you won't be experiencing God. And you won't be experiencing the life that he has for you. And you won't be able to experience fully being the church. Okay. Number two is to connect in strong relationships with followers. Say it with me again. Relationship, not religion. Relationship, not religion. So Jesus now has shown them that he's the Savior. Peter gave by revelation from God, yes, you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. He's shown them. Now he moves to explain what it means then to be his people, because being in relationship with Jesus is not an individualistic experience. It's being a part of all other people who are in relationship with Christ. And so it's being a member of a family. It's not being a member of a religion or an organization. It's being a member of a family, because it's not about religion. It's about relationship. And so when Jesus decides to introduce the disciples to this whole idea of church, he could have taken the disciples to some political center and show and said, this is going to be my kingdom. But instead, he wanted to convince them that it wasn't about religion. It was about relationship. It was as if Jesus was pointing to the temple of Baal, or the 14 temples of Baal, and saying, not a church. And he pointed to the temple of Pan. He said, not a church. Pointed to the temple of Caesar. Not a church. Even pointed to the synagogues. Said, not really a church. Let me show you what the church really is about. Verse 18 in that passage says, I tell you that you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of Hades will not overcome it. He says, Peter, disciples, and all of you that are listening, understand this. It's my church. It's not Peter's church. It's not your church. It's not anybody else's church. It's my church. And I will build my church. In other words, I will add to the body the people who are being saved, because nobody can get into this church except that they trust me as Savior and the work that I did on the cross. I'm going to build my church. And when I build my church, I'm going to give you the privilege of having the same assignment and mission that I had. And that is to go against the very gates of hell. Because I have the power over hell, and I want to let you have me within you so that that same power that is bigger than hell can flow through you. You see, we don't go to church. We are the church. And that's why we put these t-shirts together. Some of you saw them. Some of you got them on the day we did Community Day. And if you participate in a couple of weeks, September 29th, the Church Without Walls, and you participate, you'll get one of these shirts if you don't already have one. But it's when Jesus is establishing his church, he's saying, we don't go to church. We are the church. We are the church when we gather, and we are the church when we scatter. It's just whether we're together or whether we are all over the place where God wants us to be, influencing people. So being the church is not Sunday morning, although Sunday morning hopefully is part of being the church. Church happens on Sunday morning if we are being the church when we gather. But the church ought to happen all the time. Wherever Jesus' people are, church should be happening, because church is not someplace we go. Church is a people that we are. So we're worshiping now, and you're hearing the word of God preached, but and we're being the church if we're surrendering to God. But when we go out there and eat hot dogs and beans and whatever else Jeff has got planned for us out there, we still should be the church. When we're watching a roping demonstration or playing cornhole, we should still be the church. If you're taking a horse ride, you should still be the church. You see, gathering is important. Absolutely, it's important. But it's not doing church. It's being the church. So what does that look like? 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verses 14 to 18. It says, we urge you, brothers, warn those who are idle. He's talking about being the church. Encourage the timid. Help the weak. Be patient with everyone. Make sure that nobody pays back wrong for wrong, but always try to be kind to each other and to everyone else. Be joyful always, taking joy in Christ. Pray continually, being connected with Jesus all the time. Give thanks in all circumstances, recognizing that God is in charge and being grateful, for this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus. What does it mean to connect with the followers, to be the church? Let me give you a few bullet points. It's to help practically. It's to help other people in practical ways. Being the church means that we come alongside one another and help one another. He says, always be kind to each other, to everyone else. And so we come alongside one another, living life together, whether it's in small groups or informal groups and or the formal groups that we have, whether it's giving a baby shower or delivering meals or fixing somebody's car or helping somebody else with their house or giving them a ride or just listening, whatever it is, it's to help in very practical ways. It's also to encourage, to connect with other believers in relationship with other followers. It means that we encourage each other. And so he says in verse 14, 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, encourage the timid, help the weak, be patient with everyone, listen to one another when we're hurting, visit them, visit one another when we're sick or we're struggling. Give another person confidence by giving. Encourage means to give courage, strengthen them, cheer them up, hold them up. Whatever's going on in their life is to come alongside them to encourage them. And then the final bullet point is the challenge. Is the challenge. I think it's easier to do the first two, help in very practical ways or to encourage. You know, the first one's kind of the hard stuff is, you know, mowing lawns and fixing houses. The second one, encourage, is more the soft stuff, listening and caring and hugging and praying and those kinds of things. Do both those things. Then the third one is the harder one, and that is to challenge one another. Look at what he says in verse 14. Warn those who are idle. In other words, if somebody is not doing what they should be doing, spiritually, physically, relationally, in any way, our responsibility as the family of God in connection with them is to challenge them, to hold them accountable, to point to the place where they're falling and failing. He gives a specific example in verse 15. Make sure nobody pays back wrong for wrong. So if we see one another paying back wrong for wrong, come alongside, say, you know, that's not what Jesus wants. You can't do that. In Ephesians 4:15, it says, instead, speaking the truth in love, holding each other accountable, whether it's to encourage, whether it's to challenge, speaking the truth in love, we will in all things grow up into him who is the head, that is Christ. Is this far different than what you think of, or what maybe what the world thinks of in being church? Because you have to be in relationship with other people if you're going to be close enough to know when they need to be encouraged, close enough to know when they need help moving from one place to another, close enough so that you have the relationship to challenge and to chide them or rebuke them as Jesus did his disciples and as Peter and Paul did later on. We have to be close enough. There's got to be relationship. Otherwise, it's like a lot of other places that we go. If you go to a movie theater or if you go to a sports game, you know, it's much the same process. So you drive, you park in a parking lot, you walk across the parking lot, and you come to the stadium or the building, and there's somebody there, and they usually greet you. And as you're going in, you nod your head, and you're nice to them. And as you're walking through, there are other people around you. You nod your head, and you walk through, and then you sit down. And maybe there's people on either side of you that you know or you don't know, but maybe engage them in a little bit of conversation as you're going along. And then you pay attention to whether it's the movie or the game. And then when it's over, you get up, you leave, you wrestle with one another to try to get out the parking lot, and you nod your head, and you're nice, and you leave, and you go. Unless we know each other, unless we do something besides gather on Sunday morning, it's just like going to a ball game, right? We come in the parking lot, we nod our heads, we shake hands, we greet one another, we say, hi, how are you doing? We might talk to somebody on either side of us, and then we get in the parking lot and we go. And that is exactly what the Western world thinks of as church, isn't it? But that's not the church. The church is when we're connected in strong relationship with other believers. The Bible knows nothing of a believer without a congregation that they gather with. And yet we've got millions of people in our Western culture who claim to be followers but have no church home. It's connecting. I've asked David and Alicia to come up and share just for a few moments about experience they've had with being a part of the church that they've connected with.
Well, as a lot of you know, we've been in the process of adopting now for a little less than a year. And it's been a long year. And even though we keep telling ourselves that they prepared us ahead of time for it to be a long process, you know, you go into it saying, yeah, but, you know, it won't happen to me. You know, it'll be a fast thing. But to start out with, even before that process started, through a lot of different circumstances, God brought us to the point of adopting. He placed in both of our hearts a call to do that, and that we felt that that is how he wanted us to grow our family. And it's been an exciting journey. And if you'd like to talk to us more about it, I won't take a lot of time now to share, but you're more than welcome to ask about it.
So to give you some background on how the community kind of fits in with all this, God decided to make a bunch of people pregnant, which kind of pushed that call to come to actually do something about it.
Blame God for that. Yeah. Right?
So he you know, sometimes he encourages us through other people, through their walk in life. But, you know, so what we would have done is about a little more than a year ago, we started the paperwork kind of half-heartedly. And then in November, December, we sat down and said, okay, we're going to start this. And that's whenever we started telling people a new song. And it was, you know, they came up and encouraged us and asked us how it's going. And the coolest part about that is, even though they probably didn't know it, that motivated us. Because the paperwork phase can take 6 months to 10 months of your life. And we were able to complete our side of it in 2 months. It took a little while for them to finish their side. So we were more at the 6 month, but still. It's just great to have that motivation that we were able to do it quickly.
And I need that motivation.
Yeah. So, you know, then after that, you're in your waiting stage. And as many of you know, we've been in that waiting stage for a couple of months now. After the paperwork's done, you wait to be able to present your paperwork and present your family to a birth mother or birth family. And then after that, after you present it a few times, the expectation is eventually your match will come out and the birth family will pick you and say, hey, you know, I want to meet them, and they might meet you, and hopefully, you know, then they'll select you as being the family that they want to place their child with. So, you know, we've been kind of going through that that waiting stage. And so during that waiting stage,
just the church has come alongside us and been such a critical support that has made the process so much smoother and so much easier to get through, knowing that we have a family behind us that is encouraging us and praying for us and just coming alongside. I don't know how many times, you know, I've had people come and just ask if there's anything we need, or asking just how it's going and being a listening ear. And for me, as I'm a counselor, I'm kind of not used to being on that end of being the one to share, but it's a needed thing, you know, to be able to have someone listen to you and share what's going on and hear your heart and to know that there's somebody behind you and that we're not alone going through the process, because it is a difficult process sometimes going through it and having to get those things. And I'm going to tell myself I'm not going to get emotional, but
okay.
You know, just the love that we've received, it's been amazing. I didn't really expect it, to be honest. You know, I didn't expect everybody to be so compassionate and concerned for us in the process. So it's been really amazing.
And, you know, beyond just the words, some people have offered support and offered for a baby shower whenever that time comes. And, you know, they've given us help for car seats and things like that, as far as helping us, you know, make decisions. And even though it might seem unconnected, our house needed a little work for a baby, especially once I tore it apart. So, you know, offering to come help me fix my own mistakes of timing. You know, it was a huge thing, and it's encouraging. So to kind of wrap it up, so in July, we were getting close to finishing our paperwork, and about a week before, they said, hey, you know, here's a birth family. Would you like to start your submitting process, you know, to see presenting it to her? And we said, yeah, you know, it's a little early. You know, we thought this would take a little longer. But, yeah, if you think we're a good match, possibly, go ahead and submit our paperwork. And we did that. And so about 3 weeks later, we got a call and said, hey, she wants to meet with you. Which is pretty cool, you know, that we were 9 months along, you know, kind of, give or take. And so we thought, well, that's kind of neat, you know, we'll get to meet her and we'll see what happens. And that's not a guaranteed match, you know, but we were trusting. We thought, well, God, you know, that we have to do it someday. We're not going to hold back and say, you know, we're not going to. So we said yes, that we'd meet with her. And so that was supposed to happen the end of August. And that didn't happen. And it was supposed to happen the week later, and it didn't happen then. So finally, we got to this past Thursday, on Thursday, and we met with her. And the expectation of the meeting is kind of, you introduce yourself. She introduces herself. She asks questions about, you know, why you would want a child, and, you know, why you're willing to take her child, you know, or to, you know, to let her place her child with you. And so you can kind of go back and forth. And after a meeting, the idea is she'll break apart, and a couple weeks later you'll hear back as to whether or not she wants to continue with the process. Well, much to our surprise, we sat down with her, and she was a really neat lady, the birth mother, and had a great conversation with her. It only lasted about an hour and a half. And about an hour into it, she looks at us and says, yeah, I like you. We passed the test. And so to our happy joy, she signed the forms. And so this upcoming Friday, we'll have a baby already.
And you all will get to meet him next Sunday. We'll hope to bring him.
Wow. Wow.
So, he's a three-month-old boy, and his name is going to be David Jaden. The birth mother wanted the name Jaden, and we think it's a great name too, so it works well. So our dog is not so thrilled. We're trying to help her with that process, so no, it'll happen. So anyways, that's our story.
A number of weeks ago, David said, we really need a picture of our church family for our portfolio so that they can see who would be around this child, I guess. And so at the end of a worship service, we just explained it, and I heard no complaining and just excitement. We can be a part of that with David and Alicia. That's being the church family, connecting and helping and encouraging and strengthening. So let me ask you, are you connecting in those kinds of relationships? Are you taking the time informally or formally in the small groups or other activities to get to know other people so that you can share life with them, to encourage them, and to be encouraged, to help in practical ways and to be helped, to be challenged and held accountable, and to challenge and hold others accountable? What has God been telling you about building those kinds of relationships that you've just kind of set on the back burner? If we're going to be the church and experience life, satisfying life that God created, then we have to connect in strong relationships. Which brings us to number three. If we're going to be the church and experience that kind of life, we need to reach out to people in and out of Jesus Church. We need to reach out to people in and out of Jesus Church. Say it again with me. Relationship, not religion. Jesus didn't look around at the 12 that day and say, well, it's not the top of the class. Got a lot of, you know, there's 12 here and some of them that I have had questions about, but I've spent 3 years with you. seems good. That's it. Shut down the invitations. No. Jesus is never satisfied with the number of people who belong to him until every single person has the opportunity. And we can never be satisfied with the number. I mean, if we look around and we have good friendships and we have encouragement and we have a lot of good things. And one of the reasons why we have these special days and these friend days, and if you're a friend that's been invited, one of the reasons is because we believe that God has been doing something special here in the context of this church family, and we want to share it. We believe that there are more people, more adults, more youth, more children that God wants to reach in relationship with him, but also to have a group of people around them that can live life with them. Matthew chapter 5, verses 13 to 16, Jesus said at the very beginning of his ministry, he said, "You are the salt of the earth, but if the salt loses its saltiness, how can it be made salty again? It's no longer good for anything except to be thrown out and trampled by men." He's saying, I am putting myself in you so that you can bring flavor to the world. And you don't have to try. You just need to trust me and surrender to me so that you can be the person that I've created you to be. It says, "You are the light of the world. A city on a hill cannot be hidden. Neither do people light a lamp and put it under a bowl. Instead, they put it on a stand and it gives light to everyone in the house. So in the same way, let your light shine before men that they may see your good deeds and praise your Father in heaven." He says, you are the light. You're supposed to bring understanding. You're supposed to bring the truth to other people. And you don't have to work at it to be the light. You just need to be who you are if you're surrendered to me. Being, you're supposed to bring that understanding, bring that truth to light. A police officer pulled over a Christian with a custom license plate. The license plate said, "Be holy." The officer asked, "You know why I pulled you over?" The driver said, "Well, I guess I was speeding, officer. I'm late to catch a plane." The officer replied, "No, that's not why. I pulled you over because your license plate is expired." In other words, you're not holy anymore. And then he said, "Don't let time run out on your desire to be holy." If people see your life, are they seeing Jesus? They are if you're doing the first two. If you're surrendering to a powerful, loving God, if you're trusting and you're obeying him, then you're becoming more and more like him. Doesn't mean you're perfect, but it means you'll look a lot like Jesus. So we're to bring flavor. We're to bring those, I understand those aha moments to people. Church gets a bad name when people claim to be a part of the church, but they're not surrendering and obeying. They're not connecting in strong relationships. So what do we need to do? Here are the bullet points. Show. We need to show people. What do we need to show them? What God is doing, which ultimately leads to pointing to God himself. What do we need to show? We need to show that Jamie has been touched by God. We need to show that God is working in David and Alicia's lives, which is the next one is to tell. Not only do we need to show it by who we are and pointing to people, but we also need to tell people about what God is doing and what God means to us in just the natural ways of living. And then we need to invite. Invite people to experience God. And when I say invite, immediately the thing that comes to mind is, oh yeah, I should bring them here on Sunday morning to come to church. But we don't go to church. We are the church, right? And so what do we invite them to? To see God. We invite them, and maybe inviting them to a cup of coffee or a small group or invite them to help somebody move or to help move them or whatever. Now, gathering, yes. But we need to invite them to where God is doing. One of the ways that, one of the ministries that has been really powerful in being a witness, not just within the family, but in beyond that, is the hospitality ministry. And so We've over this year, we've been trying to honor some of the ministries that have been a part of New Song and making it effective. And so today, we want to honor those that are in the hospitality ministry. These are the folks who, if a person is sick, they take the meals, or if they've had a baby, or if there's a difficulty, they provide meals, they provide those kinds of practical things. But then this summer, we've also had kind of another arm of the hospitality ministry. We've got four guys that have been mowing grass for Joanne and Charlie Wilson. And so that's all comes under that umbrella. So these are the names. If you see your name up here, come on up. And if we have been honoring folks with a New Song travel mug, if you got one from a previous ministry that you're a part of, you don't get a second one. But we still want to recognize you. So be honest. We're going to check your cupboards at home. Just kidding. So come on up. Pam Lackett's, Debbie Evans, Denise Stifler, Sheila Schaefer, Renda Grable, Ginger Rogers, Wendy Libertor, Danielle Reeder, and Catherine Vail have provided meals. Come on up. And if you have done this and somehow we just missed your name, come on up anyway, because we're not perfect. And then the grass mowing ministry has been David Jacobs, Rich Offerman, Josh Reeder, and Larry Weber. You want to help me pass these out? You guys want to move this direction?
I got one.
Okay, move this direction so there's enough. What's that?
You can check my calendar.
Did everybody get one? Okay. All right. And so this is just practical ministry. And here's what's interesting as we do this. At Joanne's house, the neighbors have noticed people coming in and mowing the yard, and Joanne's been able to tell the neighbors, oh, that's my church. And I know as meals have been delivered, it has affected families and extended family members beyond just that family, to be in the church. Lord, I thank you that you have given us folks like these that are willing to sacrifice their time, their effort, their talents, their abilities. God, thank you for their example of being the church. We pray your blessing upon them, and that you would help us to be more and more like them in serving. Thank you, God. In Jesus' name, amen. Give them a round of applause. Thank you. And if you'd like to be a part of anything like that, let us know. Show, tell, and invite. Now, one more thing before we close, and that is I mentioned early about September 29th, Church Without Walls. On that Sunday, we're going to gather at 9 o'clock, and we're going to pray, and then we're going to make assignments, and then we're going to go be the church in service. Right now, we've got, we're going to be serving some folks, and here's what I'm expecting. We normally have about 60 people in worship. I expect 60-plus people to show up on that Sunday. Do not stay home. Children, youth, adults, and old people will have jobs for every category and every ability. If all you can do is sit and do something with your hands, we'll have a job for you to do that. We've got other places. We've got painting or more labor kind of work, other cleaning, lots of different things. There's a job for everyone. And so 9 o'clock on that Sunday morning, we're going to gather. We're going to pray, we're going to make assignments, and then we're going to go be the church, and then we'll hopefully get there by 9:30, and for the next 3 hours until about 12:30. If you need to leave earlier than that, drive your car, and you can leave whenever you need to leave, and that's we're going to be the church. Now, as last week I said, could we do that on a different day than Sunday morning? Absolutely we could, but it would never make the impact in us or in other people. That being the church is not just Sunday morning. It's about changing the paradigm in our minds about what it means to be the church. So do not stay home because it's different. Do not stay home because Herb's not preaching. You're probably going to have a better experience by being the church on that day and experience the blessing of God working shoulder to shoulder with other people from the New Song family than probably you have on a Sunday morning for quite some time. So that's what Church Without Walls is all about. Say it with me again. Relationship, not religion. Are you intentionally connecting with people beyond the church family for the express purpose of being the salt and light of Christ? Are you intentionally, deliberately engaging beyond so people can see Christ in you? Are there areas in your life that as people view you, their thought is not, that must be like Jesus, but rather that doesn't look good at all? If there are, surrender those to Jesus so that you can be a good representative for him. I was talking with Joanne this week. Oh, and by the way, she's been moved to the Baptist home. For those of you that have been visiting her and calling her and talking with her, she's at the Baptist home on, is that Scott Road? On Scott Road in Castle Shannon. But I was talking with her this week, and how you doing? How are your spirits? She said, I'm doing well. I said, were you pleased with the funeral? Charlie, her husband, for those of you who don't know, Joanne's husband passed away, and the funeral was a week ago, last Friday. She said, yeah. Said, you know, you don't go to a funeral to have a good time. But once you get there, you have one. And I thought, for people who are surrendered to a loving, powerful God, for people who are connected in strong relationship with other believers, and for people who are striving to be the church to people outside beyond the walls, that's exactly right. Not everybody experiences that at a funeral, but Joanne does. And it doesn't surprise any of us, does it? Because she was surrounded by family and friends that she loves because of who she is. I want to be like Joanne. I want to be like that. God wants to make you like that. Would you bow your heads? Being the church, it's a lot harder than just doing church, because relationships are a lot more intricate, involved, take more time. But it's worth it. So as I talk today, are you truly surrendering, connecting, and reaching out? Or has God pointed at some place in your heart or your life and shown you that there's some place you need to step up, surrender, let go? There is, just in this quiet moment, give it to God. Surrender it to him. Make today a turning point in that area of your life. And commit yourself with all that is in you to being the church. Not religion, but relationship. Lord, thank you that you didn't just come to this earth and work on one part of our life, religion. But God, you came to earth to transform our whole lives. And then to create a church, a group of people that we can love and laugh and care and eat and play and help and worship and do all these things together in such meaningful, deep ways. Help us to be the church more and more ourselves. Help us to help one another. But most of all, God, I pray that you would use us to reach people who desperately need you and desperately need a church family. Now, God, thank you for the time to worship. I pray that you would honor every person that has surrendered more deeply today. God, that you would put your hand upon them, draw them to yourself, and let them experience a deeper satisfaction they've ever known. And then as we go, God, as we eat and play and laugh and just enjoy the relationships that we have in a few minutes, God, I pray that we would experience being the church just as powerfully as we have this morning. Lord, we give ourselves to you. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.